Good morning, friends. My name is Karis, and I work with the worship ministry at Christ Street. We meet in the church building during the 10 o'clock hour. Trying to think of other people. Isaac over here to my left on the bass. Andrew. Matt on the drums in the back, and then we are so glad to have members from Good Shepherd. So awesome, so awesome. Joe on the banjo, Hannah on the violin. Oh my gosh. Luis, thank you. But what a privilege it is to worship freely in this country, and after this week of celebrating, we are going to do just that. We are going to celebrate even more. So if you want to stand, we are going to sing, and we're going to go before the Lord in worship, and we're going to start, like, build your kingdom here. So I think there is power in declaring that we are his church.
Build your kingdom here, let the darkness see. Show your mighty hand, heal our streets, and then set your church on fire. Win this nation back, change the atmosphere, build your kingdom. Thank you.
healing. This is amazing.
Thank you.
at this time. Oh, we're going to go right into what the people think. Okay. I was one step ahead.
This, for some reason, will not be okay. That's okay. That's okay.
What a powerful name is. The name.
be seated, everybody.
Okay, welcome. Hello. So glad you're all here. My name is Gary Beasley, and I am one of the pastors at Christ Street Fellowship. And it is such a joy to be able to get together with the Good Shepherd Church, with some of our neighbors that are visiting with us and friends, and just have a special day to celebrate God's great heart for all of us. When our service is over, don't go home, because we're going to party. We have hot dogs, we have watermelon, we have apple pie. We're going to have a wiffle ball game going out there, so all we need is a Chevrolet, and we got the whole thing, hot dogs, baseball, all of that going on. We're going to have some other things happening. A puppet show is going to take place out here, and we're going to have a demonstration of something from the Revolutionary War. Would our two demonstrators stand up here? We want to see you. There they are. Let's put it up for them. Thank you. I think one of you is the Patriot and one is the Tory. No? Okay, they're both great patriots, so it's going to be a wonderful experience today. All right, a couple of announcements before we change gears in our service. If you're a member of either the Good Shepherd Church or Christ Street Fellowship, thank you on behalf of both churches for your amazing support in every kind of way. We got volunteers out this morning to put all of this together. It's what kind of happens with small churches. Everybody does everything. We all jump in there and serve and bring watermelon and food and all of that. And thank you for financially supporting your church. If you want to give today, and you know how to do it, there's a box in the back for the Good Shepherd Church. There's another box around the corner with a cross on it for Christ Street Fellowship. And many of you already text to give or give online. So thank you for doing that. Kids, you're going to sing today. We're all going to sing America the Beautiful. But you're going to lead us in the singing. And the way you're going to lead us is to come and stand right up here in the front right now. So all of our teenagers, kids, make your way up. We have the words to three choruses of America the Beautiful right up here for you to sing. And out of all the songs we could have sung today, we picked this one because of its connection to the state of Colorado. And maybe some of you don't know this, but let me tell you. America the Beautiful was written in 1893. It's based on a poem that was written by a school teacher named Catherine Bates. She took a trip to Colorado Springs in 1893, went up to Pikes Peak, and was so amazed by the beauty of Colorado, looking down from Pikes Peak, that she wrote this poem, America the Beautiful. It appeared in print shortly after that, and within a few months was set to music. And now it's been sung for many, many decades, thanking God for the beauty of our country. So our kids are going to start us off. The words are going to be here. And if you want to sing along with them, do it. If you just want to stare at the cute kids, that's okay too. So here is America the Beautiful.
Mountains.
Hey, before you sit down, get up, give each other a hug, and say good morning to somebody.
Good morning.
If you see somebody you don't know, someone from Good Shepherd Bible Church or Christ Fellowship, go say hi to them. This is our chance to greet each other. Everyone at home, hello, we love you. God bless you. Thank you for joining us for our joint worship service with Good Shepherd Bible Church. We'll continue on in just a moment. Serving, Lord, thank you for them. And we thank you for our church family. We ask, Lord, this morning that you would speak to us through your word, the source of our true freedom in Christ. We are so thankful, Lord, above everything else. I don't care what country we lived in or what our situation is. If we have your word, then we have all we need. And so we are thankful, Lord, for it. Speak to us through your word. And we just praise you, Jesus. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen. Right. Well,
Good morning. My name is Pastor Nate. I am one of the pastors at Christ Street Fellowship. I was with you guys last year when we had our first joint worship service together, and it is my honor to get to speak to you again this morning. I'll start our teaching, and then Pastor Jay is going to come up and play cleanup. Or is that better, the cleanup batter? Is that right? Yeah. Right. I don't know my baseball, metaphors. What's that? He's the closer. No, the closer is the pitcher. But who's the batter? The cleanup batter? Cleanup. He's going to play cleanup. Or he'll be the closer. All right. Anyways, moving on from baseball. I don't know. It's America, right? Baseball. Jesus, when he lived on this earth, he spoke many, many truths. Not just one truth, and not one truth was more important than another. He spoke multiple truths that made a picture of one truth. But sometimes as believers, we get focused on one truth, and that's one of the, whatever it is, whatever Jesus would have said, we grab hold of that and we focus on that one. But God intended us for us to see all the truths together to give us a clearer picture of what his will is for our life. And so this morning we're going to look at two of those truths. And we could be here for the next 10 years and focus on all of his truths that he spoke, but we'll just do two this morning. And here are those two truths. One, Christ sets us free. He sets us free. That is the truth. And we'll talk about the scriptures that go along with that in a minute. The second truth is, we, as followers of Jesus Christ, can be one people. These aren't ideals that we strive for. They're truths that can happen now. It's not something that's like, well, if we work really hard, maybe we'll get there some. That's not what it says. It's the truth that he sets us free, and it's the truth that we can be one. One people. One in heart and one in mind. Where are the scriptures that say this? John 8:36. If you want to in your scriptures, you can open up to John 8:36. It's a scripture most of us recognize right away. They put it in songs, and it's this. So if the Son has set you free, then you are free indeed. If Jesus has set you free, in other words, if you have accepted Jesus as your Lord and Savior, he has set you free. And if he has set you free, then you are free indeed. Period. You are no longer a slave to anything or anyone. You are free in Christ. Galatians 5:13. Go a few books over. More than a few. And you'll find Galatians 5:13. And it says this, for you have been called to live in freedom, my brothers and sisters. But don't use your freedom for your sinful nature. Instead, use your freedom to serve one another in love. That is the point of our freedom. And I want to read you two scriptures about unity. The first is found in John 17:22-23. I'm having to flip back and forth and all over the place just to practice, get to know the books of the Bible, right? John 17:22-23, if you're taking notes. And this is Jesus praying for his disciples. And when Jesus is saying these things, listen to what he says. Jesus talking to the Father. The glory you have given me, I have given to them, that they may be one, even as we are one. Imagine that. Jesus and the Father are truly one. And he's saying that we would be free as they are one, or that we would be one as they are one. I in them, you in me, that they may be perfect, that they may become perfectly one. Totally aligned. So that the world may know that you sent me, and that you love them even as you loved me. And then Acts 4:32, and this is where we see the picture of the believers becoming one. And here's what it says. It says, and all the multitude of believers were one in heart and mind. It doesn't say they were striving to become that. It doesn't say that they were hoping to become one in heart and mind. It says, and the multitude of believers were one in heart and mind. So here's what's incredible. We see freedom and unity, both truths, working together. I think that's awesome. Because individually they're powerful, but together, oh man, look out. And I was thinking about things that come in pairs that we have in this world, things that we like that come together, like fruits, right? I love peanut butter and jelly. I'm not a huge fan of peanut butter by itself. I'm not a huge fan of jelly by itself. But I really like peanut butter and jelly, okay? I like it a lot. Macaroni and cheese, love that, okay? Burgers and fries. I like a cheeseburger, but if you have fries with it, oh, it's so much better. And that's just food. How about people? Sometimes we bring pairs together, and we see it throughout history, where you have one person, they come together and amazing things happen. Sherlock Holmes and Dr. Watson, right? One needs the other. They're both, individually, they're awesome guys, but put them together, they solve some pretty amazing cases, don't they? Moses and Aaron. Moses had his strengths, Aaron had his strengths, you put those two guys together, you free the Israelite people. Isn't that amazing? How about Han Solo and Chewbacca? Right? You need both. Chewbacca can't do it on his own. Han Solo can't do it on his own. Put them together, okay? Simon and Garfunkel, okay, for my dad. Simon and Garfunkel, you kids probably don't know who that is, do I? But you need those harmonies, man. You need those harmonies. Although Simon did pretty good on this. Paul Simon did pretty good on this. Anyways, each of these guys have individual strengths, but together they do awesome things. And it reminds me about, I think I've probably quoted this before, but Dave Ramsey, he in his book, Entree Leadership, he talks about this idea of horses. They're Belgian, what are they called? Belgian draft horses. Have you ever seen those? They are just muscly beasts that can pull a lot of weight. One horse can pull 8,000 pounds. And that seems pretty amazing. What's really interesting is that when you take a Belgian draft horse and you put it with another one, you would think they would double their strength. Now they pull 16,000 pounds. It's not true. Together they can pull between 20 and 24,000 pounds. Three times. But if those horses are raised together and they become one, like they've been raised, trained, and they learn to pull together as one unit, do you know how much they pull? 32,000 pounds. So one horse pulls 8,000. Two horses that have been raised together can pull 32,000 because of synergy, because their energy somehow multiplies more than just double. And I was thinking about that for this teaching. And I was thinking, one truth is powerful, the truth of freedom. Another truth of unity is powerful. But when you put these together, it doesn't just double. It triples, quadruples, it does more than we could even imagine when both of these concepts come together in us as believers. And when we follow the Word of God, when He, through His Spirit, uses them, it changes the world. Right, Pastor Gary? In the United States, we value freedom. We talk about it all the time. We fight for it. People have fought and died for it. And I'm thankful for those people. Thank you for the patriots that these guys are representing, who fought for that freedom. Thank God we didn't live underneath the rule of a king or a queen anymore. It was the voice of the people. And it's written into our Constitution. Freedom is written into our Constitution, isn't it? We have our freedoms given to us that these forefathers saw, saying, we need to write it into a Constitution, because if we don't, people will take those away. And they try all the time, don't they? They try all the time. But freedom on its own can be very dangerous. You have to have a set of rules that govern that freedom. And that's important for all of us to understand, because if we don't have those rules, we will use our freedom to infringe on another person's freedom. In our nation, I have the freedom not to like somebody, don't I? I don't have the freedom to go physically hurt that person. I don't. In our country, we have the freedom to worship as we choose, so long as that worship doesn't include human sacrifice or something else. We can worship, but there's rules. Freedom has to be governed, or else we use it for sin. So that's why in Galatians, when we read that, he says, you've been called to freedom, but don't use your freedom as an opportunity for the flesh or to fulfill your sinful desires. Rather, use your freedom to serve one another in love. So what governs freedom in our faith? It's Jesus' commands. He gives us freedom, but he gives us his commands. And what was one of his greatest commands? Love one another. Love God and love each other. Because then your freedom actually means something. And you're no longer a slave. No longer a slave to that sin and to death. So unity. Serving one another in love, you guys, that is a picture of unity. It's unity exemplified so you can see it. We can talk about unity all day long. What does it look like? It looks like me serving you and you serving me and us doing that in love. That's unity. It is not dressing the same. It's not doing everything the same and even thinking the same. We're going to have different opinions, different ideas. But it's about me serving you and you serving me in love. That's unity. Our nation is suffering an identity crisis. But it's not an identity crisis because of freedom, a lack of freedom. We don't have a lack of freedom here. Some people complain a lot about it, but trust me, we don't have a lack of freedom here. You can pretty much say and do what you want. So it's not because of our lack of freedom that we have an identity crisis. I think it's because of our lack of unity that we have an identity crisis. And it's not just in the secular world, guys. It's in the churches. Our forefathers understood the importance of unity for our nation. The saying, what's the Latin phrase? E pluribus unum? Is that what it is? E pluribus unum? Out of many, one. They understood the need for unity. All of them. George Washington, Teddy Roosevelt, Alexander Hamilton. Actually, Hamilton had a quote. Let me see. Yeah, Alexander Hamilton said this. In order for the nation to exist, he says, there has to be the energy of a common national sentiment. In other words, the people need to see themselves as one people. As Americans, as U.S. citizens, you need to see yourself in that light. But if you don't, then our nation falls apart. And what's been causing that? Well, this concept of individualism. It's really popular in our culture. Individualism. Like, I need to, you know, it's for me. And we see it in the churches. It's my personal relationship with the Lord that matters. That's what we start to think. My personal relationship. And it's how I interpret God and how I define God and what I want God to mean in my life and how I want to worship. And it's all individualism. And we stop looking at what's best for the body of Christ. How do we as a body worship? How do we as a body experience God? How do we as a body interpret his word? And individualism has gotten in, man, it has caused division so much that our churches now have, I don't know how many denominations, and many of those denominations do not speak to each other. It's like, oh, you're that? Oh, I didn't know that. Okay, well, you know, go have fun with your little group and I'll stick to my group. But is that what Jesus said he wanted for us as a church? He said that we would be one as he and the Father are one. And he wasn't just talking about your little local group of people. He was talking about us as his followers. That we would be one. And how do we accomplish that? Two ways. Freedom and serving one another in love. And you put those two things together. Amen. And you put those two things together. We get the body of Christ. And Satan cannot stop that. The gates of hell cannot win against that. They can't. Freedom and unity. And right now, Pastor Jay is going to come up here. And he's going to talk about how do we become free. But before he comes up, I want to read one scripture. And if it's one that you want to memorize or write down, it's a good one to have deep, set deep into your heart. It comes out of Philippians chapter 2. Philippians chapter 2, verse 5 through 7. Because there was no greater example of someone who was both free and unified with his people other than Jesus Christ. He is the greatest example of what that looks like. So what does it say about Jesus? Philippians 2, 5 through 7. In your relationships with one another, that's all of us, guys, all of us. The person sitting next to you, the one that is in another church down the road. It says this, in your relationships with one another, have the same mindset as that of Christ Jesus, who being in very nature God, did not consider equality with God something to be grasped. Or in other words, equality with God to be used to his own advantage. Okay? Well, what did he do? But rather, he made himself nothing. Taking on the nature of a servant, and he was made in human likeness. Our Lord, Creator, Jesus, came to the earth as one of us and served so that we could have the same mindset as him and serve one another. Amen? And I want to do that. I don't know about you. So Pastor Jay, if you want to come on up, you can tell us how we can become completely free and serve one another in love.
Maybe I could be like Pastor Gary today if I just try hard enough. Dig deeper. All
right.
Oh. I don't know, Gary, you're doing a great job, man. So I'm Pastor Jay. Turn to somebody and say, who's this guy? I don't think so. You want me to say that? So our theme today in this combined service is freedom through unity, and Nate kind of set me up a little bit. I'm not sure if I'm going to be able to explain all of that, but hopefully you don't fall asleep and we'll get something out of this. So now, I love it when we do this, don't you? I love it when we come together, right? Praise God. Getting together with other congregations, I think this is when God smiles the biggest, right? I think God smiles when we do this. Jesus said, this is how the world will know that you are my disciples, by the love you have for one another. And so we get together like this just to prove that. But you know, so we're in unity today, right? But you know, people can be in unity over just about anything, right? People can be in unity over pickleball. There's people playing pickleball not too far from us here, and they're in unity over pickleball. And I don't have anything against pickleball, just go to church first, I guess. So, people can be in unity over good pizza, right? Oh, have you tried this pizza place? Yeah, this kind of, yeah. People can even be in unity over enjoying the freedom that we have in this country because of the sacrifice of so many on our behalf. Any military veterans here today? I mean, besides our patriots. There's a military veteran. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you for your service. Freedom is not free. How many know that? Freedom is not free. Many people have paid the price for us to gather like this. Many people have paid the ultimate price. Sons, daughters, uncles, dads. Many have paid the ultimate price just so we can gather together and make fun of each other. Just so we can gather together and play a little wiffle ball. Eat apple pie, hot dogs, people have paid the ultimate price so we can have that freedom. And we need to appreciate it. I'm thankful today for the sacrifices that have been made to allow me to do this. I think we all are. We're thankful today for the sacrifices made. We're thankful for the unity being displayed here today. But I just want to point out that our unity means nothing without acknowledging the one who first reconciled us to God. The one who made unity with the Heavenly Father possible to any person who calls on His name. I depend on this scripture a lot. Some of you know I worked at the Jesus Saves downtown for 24 years, so I have problems. Anyway, but I was a chaplain downtown at the mission for a long time, and I would rely heavily on Romans 10:13. Whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. Whosoever. I love that word, whosoever. That's anybody. Rich, poor, young, old, doesn't matter the color of your skin, doesn't matter your background. Whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord. What's His name? Jesus. We had a big cross hanging off the side of the building. It said Jesus, still says, Jesus saves. It doesn't say government saves. It doesn't say your education saves. It doesn't say experience saves. It says Jesus saves. Whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. He is the one that made it possible for us to have unity with the Heavenly Father. Because if we don't have unity with the Heavenly Father, does anything else really matter? Jesus made the ultimate sacrifice on the cross so that we could be reconciled to the Father. And we read this. Oh, they found the slide. Awesome. This is 2 Corinthians 5. Therefore, if anyone is in Christ, not just around Christ, not just that you've heard of Christ, if anyone is in Christ, hiding yourself in Him. There's a song we sing, Rock of Ages, cleft for me, let me hide myself in thee. Being in Christ. If anyone is in Christ, not just around Him, not just hanging around church people, of course, if you're a normal person, I don't know if you want to hang around church people anyway. But if, you know, maybe that's your thing, you know, trying to act religious or something. But anyone who is in Christ, he is a new creation. Not just a makeover, you know, not just a pour over, a new creation. You're brand new. Old things have passed away. Behold, all things have become new. I ran into he's going to have to remind me of his name, but he's just saying, hey, I've been 10 years sober. 10 years sober. He's been going to this church for 5 years. And it's like that is old things that passed away. Behold, all things have become new. And there's only one guy that can do that. What's his name? Turn to somebody and say, it's Jesus.
Jesus.
It's Jesus. He's the only one that can do this. Old things have passed away. Behold, all things have become new. Now all things are of God, who has reconciled us to Himself through Jesus Christ and has given us the ministry of reconciliation. And so once He saves you and makes you one with the Heavenly Father, you're not done. You have a ministry. Everybody here has a ministry. And you thought, well, I'm just an attender. You know, no, everybody has a ministry. You have the ministry of reconciliation, and there's going to be a spelling test at the end of this service to make sure you can spell reconciliation. No, there's nothing. I'm just kidding. The ministry of reconciliation, that is that God was in Christ reconciling the world to Himself. Reconciling the church to Himself? The world. God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son. You've probably noticed this. I've been hanging around some Catholics lately, and Catholics are really big on crucifixes, you know, which has Jesus still on the cross. You know, we're here today because Jesus is no longer on the cross. But here's the thing, you know, when Jesus died on the cross, His arms were spread wide open. Wide open. Whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. Right? He's got the whole world in His hands. He's got the whole world in His hands. right? Reconciling to himself, not imputing their trespasses against them. In other words, canceling their debt, and has committed to us the word of reconciliation. We still have a responsibility. Once we've been saved and healed and delivered, it's our responsibility to walk out this door into this dirty world and spread the news. Hey, God, you've been reconciled to God. The price has been paid. All you got to do is call upon his name. Whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. Now then, we are ambassadors for Christ. You didn't know you were an ambassador, did you? Turn to somebody and say, you're an ambassador.
You're an ambassador.
Turn to a person on the other side and say, I'm an ambassador.
I'm an ambassador.
That's a pretty big title. We are ambassadors for Christ as though God were pleading through us. You know, I've been thinking about the heart of the Father. And I've been studying the prodigal son. You know, in Luke 15, the end of Luke 15, and the prodigal son, you know, gets his inheritance and he goes off and he spends it all, you know. And he comes back and the father sees him in the distance and runs to him and embraces him and welcomes him back into the family. And then the tragic thing about that story, at the end of the story, the older brother, he finds out what's going on and he doesn't even come in. He says, I'm not going into that party. I'm not rejoicing that my younger brother was found. I'm not going to do it. And the father comes out and pleads with him to come in, to enter in. Does the older brother do it? How many know the story? The older brother doesn't do it. He never enters in. But Heavenly Father, his heart is that we enter in and rejoice over those who are being saved, those who are being reconciled, those who are coming down the road of repentance. And so, God was in Christ, reconciling the world to himself. We are ambassadors. God is pleading through us. We implore you on Christ's behalf, be reconciled to God. That's our message. For he made him, Jesus, God made Jesus, who knew no sin, to be sin for us, that we might become the righteousness of God in him. God has made it possible to be one with him. Until we are in unity with God, nothing else will come into focus. Until we are in unity with God, we will still have a restlessness in our hearts. Augustine said it this way. He says, and this is in one of his prayers, thou hast made us for thyself, and our hearts are restless till they find their rest in thee. Maybe you're restless here this morning. Maybe it's because you've not found your rest in Christ. Now, how did God accomplish this monumental feat of unifying us, reconciling us to himself? How did God bring us into unity with himself? What mechanism did he use to do this? It's the cross. It's the cross. Turn to somebody and whisper, it's the cross. It's the cross. I want you to take a good look at the cross here. And I think I put one in the picture up here. Take a good look at the cross, or maybe anybody have a cross necklace? A lot of people wear those, or cross earrings, right? There you go. Any cross tattoos? I don't know if anybody in Good Shepherd has tattoos, but you know, that's why we hang out with you guys. We're trying to look cool. You know? We'll be alright. Yeah. But after today, I'm hoping that you never look at a cross the same way ever again. What do you notice about the cross? What do you notice? I want you to notice this. Notice that the vertical beam is twice the size as the horizontal beam. The vertical beam is at least, depends which cross you're looking at, the vertical beam is at least twice the size as the horizontal beam. I think this tells me, and it should tell us, that our vertical relationship with God is twice as important as any horizontal relationship with people on the earth. Does that make sense? If I seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, if I get my vertical intact, then God will come along, he'll make the horizontal things that I've been worried about, he'll provide those. He'll get those all added unto me, and they will come into the proper focus. Too often we approach God to get him to make some horizontal thing on this earth to work out for us. How many do that? You approach God kind of trying to manipulate him. God, if you make this horizontal thing work out, then I'll seek you. No, that's backwards. It doesn't work that way. You seek first the kingdom of God. You get your vertical intact, and then your horizontal comes into focus. Matter of fact, if you don't have your vertical intact, your horizontal doesn't even get off the ground. You've got to seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness and let him add all these other things unto you. And then your horizontal will come into focus. What happened? What happened on that hill of Calvary? What happened from noon to 3 when it was dark? I think what happened, it was God reconciling the world to himself. That's what was happening. Reconciliation was happening. God was reconciling. God's love and grace was being shed on you and on me in the form of Jesus' blood. So we need to thank God, first of all, for giving us unity with him through the cross, through the sacrifice of his son. And then we need to give thanks for the unity that he's caused among us. I'm so thankful to just be across the parking lot from you guys. We pray for you guys. We just love the way God does this. And we've been talking about doing this more than once a year. You know, I'm trying to, you know, figure out how to be around Nate and Gary more than once a year. Anyway, I do have a song here for you. This is a song I wrote. Wilson, he's on the ball. Turn to somebody and say, that Wilson is on the ball. Oh, am I Judas who betrays you for money? Am I Peter who denies you to live? Crying out for mercy, Jesus, Son of David, my sins you forgive. In the shadow of the cross, you hide my sins away. In the shadow of the blood shed for me that day. In the shadow of the cross, all forgiveness now is mine. And the morning star does shine. Lord, I can see what you've done for me at the cross. Will I follow you out of the city? Will I follow you up to the hill? Will I lay my life down in your shadow, clinging and crying, Lord, please have your will. In the shadow of the cross, sing with me, you hide my sins away, in the shadow of your blood, in the shadow.
For me that day, in the shadow of the cross, in the shadow of the cross, forgiveness now is mine, forgiveness now is mine, and the morning star does shine, Lord, and I can see what you've done for me. The cross. You loved me when I was unlovely. You loved me when I was unlovely. You loved me, Lord, when I was so unlovely. In the shadow of the cross, you hide my sin, you hide my sin away. In the shadow of your blood, sent for me that day. In the shadow of the cross, forgiveness now is mine, forgiveness now is mine, and the morning star does shine, Lord, and I can see what you've done for me at the cross. Oh, Jesus, I can see what you've done for me at the cross. Can you sing that with me? Lord Jesus, I can see what you've done for me at the cross.
Thank you so much. Father God, thank you so much for reconciling us to you through the blood of your Son, Jesus. Thank you so much for making it possible for us to be in unity with you, and thereby in unity, proper unity, with each other. Thank you so much, Lord. You're so good. You certainly do keep shedding your grace on this nation and on your people. Thank you, Lord. Bless the rest of this day and all the... Are we doing worship? We're doing more worship? What else are we doing? Oh, we're going to go eat? I don't know, the food looks pretty good. Does it need prayer? All right, sure. We'll thank the Lord. Father God, we just thank you, Lord, for this fellowship that we're going to have. Thank you for this food that we're going to enjoy. Thank you for the freedom. Thank you for your love and kindness. Thank you so much, Lord, for all these Jesus freaks in one room. Thank you, Lord. In Jesus' name, everyone said, amen. Amen. Thank you, God.
I just got an update on the hot dogs. They will not be ready for 15 more minutes. However, we have pie, we have watermelon, we have chips and drinks, so you can get those. You can go to benches sitting out here between the two buildings. There are also benches on the other side of the parking lot between two buildings, and there are tables in here. So if you want to eat some of those things now, eat them now. Some of you are more fastidious and you want to wait for the entire plate to be ready, then you can wait for that. And once that's done, what time is the puppet show going to start?
I don't know. Hannah, what do you think? What time?
12:30. We're having a puppet show right out over here. What time is the wiffle ball game going to start?
We could start that anytime.
I think we'll see.
The Revolutionary War demonstration. What time are we doing?
What time is the Revolutionary War demonstration? 1 o'clock for the Revolutionary War demonstration?
You can try to eat and pretend you're free, but you're not going to be free until 1 o'clock, really. So.
All right, so any questions? You know what you were doing? 15 minutes, the hot dogs will be ready. Otherwise, go get your food now. Celebrate, make a new friend. Enjoy.
Dun, dun, dun.